out of your belly,
out of your
shall flow,
out of your
rivers of living water,
out of your
out of your belly,
out of your
shall flow,
out of your
rivers of living water,
out of your
shall help me
sing,
out of your belly,
out of your
shall flow,
out of your
rivers of living water.
Welcome to the Men of Integrity, men that rescue men and women. And we are excited and delighted at all of the things that God is doing for His people in times like this. I want to encourage you to be encouraged because the best is yet to come. God's promises are sure, and we are receiving everything that God has declared if you are a believer. We have tonight with us Apostle J. Edward Fisher, Saint Center, Coppers Cove. The Apostle G.L. Grace from New Balance Believers here in the city of Killeen, Texas. We want you to partner with us. Don't forget to sow that seed of faith. The address is on the screen. We want you to partner and help us to get the gospel to those that are less fortunate than you and I. Somebody is being redeemed by the word of the Lord. Call a neighbor, call a friend, and tell them the Men of Integrity is on the air right now.
Amen.
Tune in for this life-changing experience. Mm-hmm. The word of God tonight, brothers, is going to be found in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 8 through 10. A very familiar passage of Scripture. It says, "We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but we are not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our bodies." I want to address the issue tonight, the commitment of God in times like these. And I want to say to you, audience, tonight, as we break open this word of God, to keep this thought in mind. Just because your problem is present does not mean that God is absent. You must keep your commitment even in times like these, times of uncertainties. Brethren, there is a deceitful mindset that produces a thought that just because problems are present, then God appears to be absent. Mm-hmm. And I find that to be so untrue. Yeah. What do you guys think about that?
Well, I think, Bishop, really, sometimes we meditate more on the problem. Again, then on the answer, which is God. And so again, we become distracted, you know, and just looking at the problem. You're right, though, it tends to think, oh God, where are you in the midst of these things? And so again, we got to focus on the word and not on the issue.
Yeah, we forget the exhortation that He's told us, that He'd never leave us, nor forsake us, but we're so much into the flesh that we go by feelings rather than by what God actually said. Yeah.
Absolutely. When you stop and you look at Psalms 32 and 8, He says, "I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go."
Mm-hmm.
So you cannot be focusing on situations and circumstances in times like these.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be focused on the direction that God say you should go. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like there's a big accident here on the highway, but the police is directing you in the way that you should go. If you're watching the accident or the catastrophic events, then you're going to cause another accident because you're not paying attention of how to get through the mayhem.
Mm-hmm.
And brothers, there is a lot of stuff going on right now. These are perilous times.
Yeah.
But God says, listen, I am directing you.
Mm-hmm.
I'm teaching you. Look at that text. I will teach you.
Mm-hmm.
I will instruct you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eyes upon you.
Mm-hmm.
God says, I'm watching you, I'm directing you, and I'm showing you the way that you should go.
Yeah. Well, Bishop, I think you hit it so square there on the head that we got to learn how to stay focused. And when God is directing us, the strategy of Satan is to distract.
Yes.
And that's why he called Beelzebub. We mention this all the time because he's the master of distraction.
Yes.
You know, and so we got to learn that discipline to continue to listen to God and continue to follow God, especially, like you said, when there's mayhem all around us. What was the last thing God said? What did He say He's going to do?
Yes.
Let's stay focused on the Word of God.
Yes.
Yeah, and He just said, having done all,
yeah,
just stand.
Yes.
You know, a lot of things will be happening around us, But we got to stand in the instruction that God has given us, regardless of what it looks like.
You know, when the writer says a house divided against itself, it cannot stand. Yeah. Mm-hmm. When you're thinking in your mm-hmm. mentality is divided. Can God, will God, and then I'm looking at all of the stuff that is happening. You're going to crumble, you're going to fall, because you must obey Psalms 32 and 8. Mm-hmm. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. Yeah. Don't worry about what everybody else is doing. You got to stay on the path that God says you should go.
Yeah.
Then he says, I will counsel you with my eyes upon you. Mm-hmm. There is never a time when he does not see me. Mm-hmm. There is never a time when he does not know my condition. So I want to say to you tonight in very simple terms, stop tripping. God knows exactly where you are, and God knows exactly the condition that you are in. Mm-hmm. But you have to hear the word of God, and he says, you're going to have to be committed now to the things that I'm instructing you and teaching you, and you're going to have to go in the direction that I'm telling you to go.
Right. Yeah.
Let me throw this in and y'all jump in. Job 23, 8 and 10. Yeah. Behold, I go forward, but he is not there. Backwards, but I cannot perceive him. On the left hand, where he doeth work, but I cannot behold him.
Mm-hmm.
He hideth himself on the right hand, but I cannot see him. But he knoweth the way that I take.
Yeah. Right.
When he has tried me, I shall come forth as gold. Just because your problems are present doesn't mean that God is absent. You must be committed to the direction which God says you must go.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Bishop, that's a great story when you use Job, because Job had some problems. But you know, if we read Job chapter 1 and 2, we see where the problem originated. And what we have to do as believers, again, so we don't get distracted, is to understand where everything starts, and that's mm-hmm. in the spirit realm.
Mm-hmm.
And even looking at Job's life, one thing in Job 23 later, he'll say, the word of God have I esteemed greater than my necessary food.
Yeah.
So we got to learn how to stay planted. As Apostle said earlier, we got to stay locked in on the word. We got to, after standing, learn to stand on that word, no matter what it looks like around us.
That's right.
God can't lie.
Yeah.
He cannot change. So we got to stay with that word.
Yeah, and then, you know, Job said this here. He said, you know, we have anxiety about whether I went the right way or I made the right turn. He said, you don't have to worry about that. He said, God knows what Darryl Shaw is going to do all the time. He knows us. So he knows where we're going to be at.
Yeah.
And that's and that gives me great comfort, because God knows me.
Yeah.
And so I don't have to be concerned about whether I miss God or not. God won't miss me.
Yeah.
Oh, real good.
You know, that's really good. The commitment part of this is very good. It's something that God has been dealing with me, and I've been sharing it with our congregation. The scripture for us this year is Psalms 37 and 5.
Mm-hmm.
Commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. Yeah, it is God that has to bring it to pass, but he will not bring it to pass unless there is a commitment on your behalf to follow the instructions and the way that God said go. Now, if God told you to go straight and you find yourself taking a right turn, now, it ain't God's fault. You are going to experience life based upon your commitment.
Yeah.
So watch this. My brothers and sisters, if your commitment level is the same as it was last year, you're going to get the same results this year.
Oh, yeah.
So there's no use in making all these resolutions unless your resolution is to be committed to the ways of God. He says, commit thy way, mean do it my way. And if you do it my way, then trust in my way, and then I'll bring it to pass. Whatever it is you need, whatever it is you want, you have to trust in me as God.
Yeah. Bishop, I want to just throw this in there, but Apostle said something that we may miss God, but God will never miss us, which means being that God is omnipresent. He's omniscient.
Yes.
He's all-powerful, all-knowing. He's everywhere at the same time.
Yes.
So what we have to understand is that basically it is God that's working in us anyway, both the will and the to-do. So he's at work. That's why we have to follow his lead. We don't know what he's doing. We got to trust him.
Yes.
And again, Proverbs chapter 3, lean not to our own understanding.
Yes.
We got to trust in him. We got to trust. And really, we all believe, but we don't trust until we're pressured.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, until we're tried.
Yes.
And so that's the thing. You know, just like the children of Israel, they had to learn to trust God in the wilderness. And the wilderness, according to Deuteronomy 8, was, again, the intent of God.
Yes.
God did that on purpose.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So I think this, brethren, that God sometimes allows things to happen so that we can become co-laborers with Him.
Yes.
You know, in the earth realm, that we're a reflection of God in the earth.
You mm-hmm. know, you said something in a few series ago, the idea of being in agreement with God.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah.
If
yeah.
we don't agree with God, yeah. then certainly we're not going to be committed to God. Sometimes yeah. we want what we want, but
yeah,
that's
yeah.
not what God wants.
Yeah, yeah.
That's not the direction He wants to take us, so mm-hmm. we have to be in agreement with Him.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, you said something. We have to grow in commitment, too.
Growth.
Yes.
Growth.
The commitment you had last year,
yes.
God expects you to have a greater commitment this year. He expects
yes.
us to bound. He expects us to keep moving forward
mm-hmm.
and grow in grace and in
yeah.
the knowledge of God. So you're right, that commitment we had last year might not be even sufficient for mm-hmm. this year.
Yes.
And so we got to be pushing forward.
Yeah. You know, the commitment has to be to God,
mm-hmm.
not to anything else, because
you
when you're committed to God, the rest of the things will fall in the right
oh,
order,
yeah.
in the
oh,
right
yeah.
perspective.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
But you have people that are more committed to themselves, or they're more committed
right, right,
to
right.
what they call ministry or what they call church.
Yeah.
But you got to understand that that stuff falls in perspective when your commitment is first to God.
Mm-hmm.
It's
yeah.
just like the writer says, he says, have faith in God.
Yeah.
Okay. And
mm-hmm.
when you have faith in God, everything else falls in the right perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Let's drop this in here. When we fail to realize that God assumes absence is a part of salvation's story. It's somehow part of the providential plan. Yet, silent doesn't feel normal in our understanding of God
mm-hmm.
because we are so used to reading how Goliath was slain by David, Joshua triumphs around Jericho, Elijah's chariot of fire, and all the miracles that
mm-hmm.
Jesus done. So, as believers, we sometimes forget what it looks like when God appears to be silent and inactive.
Yeah.
But God is allowing us the opportunity to listen to the still small voice of God so that we can obey Him by faith.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
See, all the time is not the slaying of the giant, the walls of Jericho falling,
yeah.
you know, and all of the miracles and things that Jesus done. Sometimes it's just an obedient walk.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's it, Bishop, I'm telling you. Just simple obedience. Simple obedience where we're being tested, tried. Simple obedience and not doing all what you may call the theatrical or the great spectacular thing. Sometimes it's just simple obedience. And I believe it gets back to God desiring for us to represent Him in the earth. And that's why we don't understand problems. So we lack in the area of commitment. See, God is always committed.
Yes.
He's unchanging.
Yeah.
He cannot lie. He's always the same. So what we have, like you said, Bishop, I think one of the greatest work of the flesh is idolatry.
Yes.
Where we're so much concerned about self. You know, and I think that's one of the greatest sins is selfishness.
Mm-hmm.
We're so selfish,
mm-hmm.
you know, and so we want what we want when
yeah.
we want it. So then we're selfish, and then we have a lack of patience.
Yes.
You know, so then we're not committed.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. And when we were really committed, even though we have agendas, right,
mm-hmm.
our agenda must give way to the will of God.
Yeah.
Just
oh,
like
yeah,
Jesus
yeah, yeah.
said, not my will, but thy will be done. And sometimes we're so much into our agenda that we block everything out. We don't worry about what God's agenda is. We just want what we want. But that's
mm-hmm.
not commitment to God. That's commitment to ourselves.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
ourselves, you know, we just not that good.
Yes. I'll challenge you tonight
mm-hmm.
to check your commitment to God
mm-hmm.
without all of the fanfares.
Mm-hmm.
And even if God don't speak, what is your commitment like?
Mm-hmm.
Even if God don't work the miracle, what is your commitment like? The Bible says in Psalms 37:5, I won't ever deviate from this again, is that commit thy way
mm-hmm.
unto the Lord. Trust also in Him, and He shall bring it to pass. That's concerning your relationships. That's concerning your finances. That's concerning your children. Everything must be committed into the hands of God. And we, as a child of God, must be able to walk in the obedience of God. Let me throw this in, and I want you all to jump in here. In Psalms 23,
mm-hmm.
there is my part, and there's
yeah.
God's part. Here is God's part. The Lord is my shepherd.
Mm-hmm.
Here's my part. I shall not want. He is God's part. He making me to lie down in green pastures. Mm-hmm. He leading me beside the still waters. He restored my soul. He leading me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. He is my part. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadows of death, I will fear no evil. He is God's part. Thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, it comforts me. Thou prepared the table before me in the presence of my enemy. Thou anointed my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. He is my part. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So when you look at Psalms 23, okay, God says, listen, I don't want you to have wants. I don't want you to walk in fear because what? I'm with you, and I want you to remain in the house of the Lord. So if I remain in the house of the Lord, I won't be walking in fear. And he's going to what? Fulfill all of my needs that I have no need. My commitment to God must be to not walk in fear, to dwell in the house of the Lord. Does that make any kind of sense? There's a commitment there.
And Bishop, that is so. Psalms 23, of course, we know is one of the most famous scriptures in the Bible, and it's a powerful story. And it starts off with God is. You know, he's just simply saying the Lord is. And so what we have to do is go back to something you said, Bishop, is that we got to come in agreement. We got to come in agreement, first of all, that he is my shepherd. That's the first thing we got to do. We got to agree, and we have to align ourselves. And then if he's our shepherd, we got to wait on him to guide us. Sheep don't just run off in the pasture, just do what they want to do. If he says he's going to lead me to green pasture, he didn't tell me to run out there and find the green pasture.
That's right.
I got to submit myself. I got to lose my opinion of what I think or where I think the green pasture is and where I think the still waters is. I got to, he know what he's doing. So I got to submit to him and wait on him and not get something in my mind that I want and be obsessed with it and just got to, again, just submit to his word.
So watch this, Apostle, you jump in after this here. But then after that, he says, now, though I walk through the valley of the shadows of death. Now, if he's leading me beside the still waters and leading me in the green pastures, this same leading is leading me in the valley of shadows of death. But he says, listen, I am so sure that he's leading me, I will not fear.
I will not fear.
I'm not going to fear. Fear is destroying the commitment of God's people in times like these.
And we just have to have an understanding that the shepherd knows. I mean, he knows what he's got to do. If there's running water, right, he's going to go up the stream and dam it up so that it stops flowing because your sheep got all that wool, And he don't want to be in that water. And so the shepherd knows everything. He knows the way to take. It may not be the way we want. But he knows it's the best way for the sheep. And that's our problem. And sometimes the long way is the best way.
Let me ask this here. So then, you know, when God is leading us, he says two things he says he's going to do. He's going to prepare a table. But look where he prepares the table. In the presence. And Bishop, you said, you know, you was alluding to this earlier. He, though he lead me in the valley, in the shadow of death, which means if there's a shadow, whatever's casting the shadow is not far away. So that means he's going to lead me that close to death. And then he said, look, I'm not going to fear any evil. Why? Simply because the beginning of this, he is my shepherd. He is my shepherd. He's preparing a table before our enemies. In other words, he says, don't focus on the enemy. Get ready to eat.
Let me say that something right there, too. You know, and of course, in that wilderness, you might even hear the wolf hollering. But you don't have to be focused on the hollering of the wolf. You just need to look over and see if the shepherd is still there. And if he's still there, let the wolf
let
howl.
Let him do what I don't do.
Thou rod and thou staff.
There you go.
He got, it comforts
that's
me.
That's right.
Oh, glory to God. That's a word of comfort for those that are committed. I want to do a couple of points in here real quick. The first thing we want you to grasp tonight is this. You must realize that problems are real. In 2 Corinthians 4 and 8, Paul made it very clear. We are troubled on every side, but yet not distressed. We're perplexed, but not in despair. But can you see the presence of God in this?
Oh, yeah.
Because, yeah, we have trouble, but we're not distressed.
That's
we're
right.
not distressed because of the presence of God in the midst of all of this chaos and mayhem.
Yeah, that's
I
right.
want to tell you tonight that the comfort of the Holy Spirit keeps you in times like these so you can keep your commitment to God to walk in faith and obedience to the Word of God.
Yeah.
He says, we're persecuted but not forsaken, cast down but not destroyed. So even though I'm cast down, the presence of God is not allowing me to be destroyed. So whatever you're going through, you have to understand it can't destroy you. It's not destroying your mind. Get a grip. Get a grip on your mind and know that the Word of God does not fail.
Yeah.
Y'all hit part number one real quick for us.
Well, what I want to say real quick, Bishop, is that we're troubled on every side, which means we need to look up.
Yes.
You know, ain't no trouble up. We need to look up and live. Yeah. David said, I will look to the hills from which cometh my help. So again, you back to that point, Bishop, there's a comfort for those that are committed. So we just got to stay committed to the promise of God, the Word of God.
Yeah, and then he said, you read it in Psalms 32, 8, he said, he will guide us with his eye. Well, his eye, if you watch it, is the Spirit
of God. It's the Spirit.
And remember, Jesus called him a comforter.
Yes.
So
he's going to be right there to comfort us, lead us, guide us into all truth, tell us exactly what it is. We just got to stay with the eye.
Yeah. So because problems are real, you need a real word from God.
There you go.
You need a real experience with God.
Hallelujah.
So that he can guide you through those. Point number two is you must regain a new perspective. In John 16 and 33, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Jesus is saying this world will have problems, but you got to cheer up. Your attitude must be, we go through, but we come out victorious. My commitment to God is going to bring it to pass. Deuteronomy 31 and 8, it is the Lord who goes before you. He will be with you. He will not leave you or forsake you. Do not fear or be dismayed. Get a new perspective. God said, do not fear or be dismayed. Jump in on that.
Well, a new perspective, Bishop and Apostle, I believe we got to renew our mind. Romans 12, 1 and 2. We got to learn how to think like God. No matter how strange that may sound, according to Isaiah 55, we supposed to have his thoughts. We supposed to think like God in order to see like him. So we have his perspective on a problem.
Yes.
Sometimes I think discouragement come in because we are thinking one way when God said, no, that's not how I see it's going to come out. I believe all things are going to work together for your good.
Look at that camera and prophesy concerning that word.
I just want to say to the people that's viewing right now, Romans 8, 28 says, all things going to work together for your good. In this year, I believe that all things going to turn into your favor.
Yeah.
And then, you know, the Bible says, count it joy when you fall into trials, right? And so we got to, instead of look at the negative of it, we got to remember what the positive of it, that in the end, I'm going to have joy. And then it says, with joy, we draw from the well of salvation.
Man, look in the camera and prophesy the people of God.
But I tell you that, watch this here, you just got to hold on to the Lord and keep your faith in the Lord. And your faith is the victory that overcometh the world.
Here's the word of God, Psalms 37 and 5. Trust in the Lord. Commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he will bring it to pass. That, my brothers and sisters, you can bank on this year. That if you just turn your ways to the obedience of God's direction and trust in what he said, God says, I'm going to take care of this. You don't have to worry about trying to fix this. I'm going to fix it for you. I'm going to fix your children. I'm going to fix your finances. I'm going to fix your salvation. I'm going to fix your mindset.
Amen.
Don't faint in your mind.
That's right.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart.
That's right.
Lean not to your own understanding. And all of your ways acknowledge him. And he says, I will direct your path.
Amen.
I'm getting excited.
Amen.
Here's point number three real quick. Not only must you do point number one, realize that the problems are real. Number two, regain a new perspective, but you must release the power of God. In Isaiah 40 and 29, he gives power to the faint and the weary. And to him who has no might, he increases strength. mm-hmm. causing it to multiply and make it abound. As believers in Christ, the Holy Spirit lives in our spirit.
Yeah.
What are we talking about here, releasing the power of God?
Mm-hmm. I believe, Bishop, that what must happen is that the authoritative power of God must manifest in the believer, which mm-hmm. is through the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
And again, but here's the catch. The power doesn't manifest until it's necessary.
Yes.
Which means there must be a trial, there must be a problem, there must be a sickness, there must be something in order for the power of God to manifest, because the power of God is for the purpose of God.
Yes. Yeah, and then we must exercise the things like patience, right?
Yeah.
It says, in your patience, you possess your soul, and you have need of patience.
Yeah.
And patience is a powerful force.
Yes.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
it will eventually bring us into perfection, and we shall not want for any good thing.
Yeah.
Releasing the power of God, you got to release that word.
Mm-hmm. Oh, there you go.
Jesus says to Paul, my grace is sufficient and my strength is made perfect in a time of weakness.
Mm-hmm.
But you must speak what Jesus says in Mark 9 and 23. If thou can believe, mm-hmm. all things are possible to him that believe. The power is faith. Mm-hmm. He that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
Yeah.
The problem can't be your concern, my beloved. Your commitment must be your concern. You must be concerned about the level of commitment that you have to God. Commit thy way unto the Lord, he shall bring it to pass. If you want it to be done,
yeah.
you have to have a commitment to God. Jump in here.
I see, we got to get back to, again, focusing on Acts chapter 1, verse 8. He says, again, after that the Spirit of God has come upon you, you shall receive power. Luke 10 said, behold, I give unto you power. The authoritative nature of God must manifest in the believer. Mm. So the problem must manifest in order for God to show up and fix it.
Wow. Yeah. Did you get that?
Mm-hmm.
The problem must show up
yeah.
for God to show up and fix it. Come on, 30
yeah,
seconds.
Yeah, and then, you know, the Bible says the kingdom of God is not in word, but
oh,
in
yeah.
power.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Wow. It is so exciting to understand this year. It's our commitment level
mm-hmm.
that's going to bring the power of God's manifestation. The whole earth is moaning and groaning, waiting for the manifestation of
yeah.
the sons
yeah.
of God. You got to do more than talk.
Yeah.
Paul says, I didn't come in excellent speech and enticing words,
there
but I came in power,
power
and demonstration of the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
10 seconds, say something to the people.
I just want to say what they're going through right now, your trial is a classroom of learning for the power of God to demonstrate.
Wow.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And then I just say, just be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might.
Yeah.
I want to say to you, I reckon that the suffering of this present time is
not
to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed at the presence of his coming.
Right.
For these light afflictions worketh a greater recompense of reward.
Yeah.
God wants you to be committed in times like these. Look unto Jesus, who certainly is the author and the finisher of our faith. Faith gets it done, my brothers and sisters.
Hallelujah.
Don't forget to partner with us. Write that check out tonight to KPLE. Let's help somebody else be empowered by the Word of God. The address is on the screen. Join us in any of our services for a life-changing experience.
Hallelujah.
Remember, we're praying for your miracle in times like these.
Hallelujah.
Out of your belly,
out of your
shall flow
out of your
rivers of living water.
Out of your belly,
big water.